Okay, welcome back to the Tuesday show. Like we said, our guests have skedaddled. Mm-hmm. And that means we're alone. By the way, I don't think we actually addressed this earlier, but Tasty Steve and Sage Jam are at GDC this week. I think doing Breakaway?
I think, yeah, stuff. They're doing Breakaway stuff, yeah. Uh-huh.
Commentary for the new game Breakaway. That's cool. You know, shout outs to them. But as a result, they are not here. So let's move on now to talk about this article that Choco Blanca put out. I thought it was an interesting topic, you know, point.
Okay.
So I'm gonna paste it in the chat. I know other people have done this as well. And when you YouTube this, can you put that in the old YouTube description?
I'll try to remember, sure.
Okay. There's the thing. So essentially it's about sort of the viability and some thoughts about esports in Japan. And how it's not really a thing, right? So Japan does not have a mature esports market, is a big part of this.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it talks about how her choices have been to sort of help build that, but how it seems like every year people say this is going to be the year of esports.
Yes.
And it just kind of keeps happening.
Yes.
I mean,
yes.
I think we've all experienced that even in other parts of the world, but in Japan as well, I suppose. And, you know, she identified a big part of that as being that esports or video games, I guess, are not considered to be a profession.
Mm-hmm.
In Japan. It's not only
mm-hmm.
Japan that feels that way, of course, but that is, you know, a big sort of hindrance to it being accepted more, she says. On top of that, you know, only a few gaming-related companies, like, really market heavily in Japan. When streams happen, when footage happens, it's timed. Even people in Japan do this. They time it so that people in North America can watch. It's like that market is prioritized.
Right.
Which
even
makes
to the
sense.
Point, like, the Topanga League, you know, they have to have that English stream going, right? And there's a lot of people watching on the English stream as well.
This guy, I gotta be honest,
yeah,
I mean,
I have definitely fallen asleep to the dulcet tones of CN's voice, and CNN cameraman's voice and such. You know, I'll just have it on my, like, iPad while I'm next to my bed, and I'm just, like, watching it, and then I just pass
it.
Oh, yeah,
I just wait until the next day. I don't even pretend that I can do that. But I guess that's part of the issue, right, is that I can't really stay up.
Uh-huh.
A lot of people are in the same position. You got stuff to do in the morning in
uh-huh.
North America, so you can't really watch a normal Japan-timed thing.
Uh-huh.
And since so much of the audience for esports is North America / Europe, when it comes to Japan, it's, you know, difficult getting things going.
Right, yeah. I was even talking to Majin Obama, for example, a.k.a. 2D Jazz, who's been running the Tenkaichi Budokai series for Guilty Gear.
Mm-hmm.
And he says that they, whenever they broadcast over the weekends, you know, it's on Twitch. And the Twitch stream itself rarely gets over 1,000 viewers or something like that. Like, it gets, like, right over 1,000 viewers. There's not many people. Now, I think they do stream it on Nico Nico at the same time, so maybe that's where most of the Japanese players are watching it. But, I feel like Guilty Gear is so big in Japan that something that cool with all those players would just be,
right,
like, views all over the place, you know?
Right, yeah. We tend to think in, at least in North America, that Japan is, like, the place
mm-hmm.
for video gaming, right?
Yeah.
Like, you go there, you get to play all day in the arcades. It's glorious. But there historically has not been the same kind of tournament scene there
uh-huh.
as in North America. People play it a lot, obviously,
right,
but the same kind of, like, lots of people enter a tournament to win money kind of thing was illegal
mm-hmm.
/
mm-hmm.
nobody did it anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And tournaments were, like, best of one, you know, SBO, for example, best of one, single elimination, kind of janky rules from our
characters,
yeah,
you know, et cetera, et cetera.
Right,
yeah.
So that kind of history is not really there as much as people might think.
Right.
And so she talks about how she wants to focus on creating sort of the idea, the example of somebody who makes a game, esports, their career, and does it in a way that's, like, respectable and doesn't take a $1 billion.
I don't know if you've had a chance to sit down and read Daigo's book yet.
No.
But Daigo talks about that a lot. I mean, that was a thing. It was like when he first started trying to play games, one of the reasons why he quit was because there just was nothing in the cards. You know, there was no future for this kind of thing because no one in Japan considered this an actual thing. Like, you couldn't make a career out of it. When Street Fighter 4 hit and he realized it could be something, that's kind of when he jumped back into it. And previous to that, he was just playing Mahjong and entering a bunch of Mahjong tournaments, you know, and he got himself to the point where he was one of the best Mahjong players in Japan. But, you know, as soon as he saw that he could do this with video games, he was like, you know, he wanted to be the example to set to other people that you could make this kind of job with the video games. But so far, it sounds like he's still kind of like the only one, you know, judging from what Choco Blanca is writing about here.
Well, obviously Choco Blanca and Momochi are trying to make this work. I mean, this is their job,
mm-hmm,
right?
Mm-hmm,
so
mm-hmm.
So they are among the few examples of people who are doing gaming as a
mm-hmm.
career.
And that's, I mean, that's what Shinobiism is, the group that,
right.
the school, essentially, that Momochi has created, that Haku is from, for example, the bison player
mm-hmm.
who was in the Topanga League. You know, they're trying to create the school where there's a bunch of kids who can learn and play video games and understand esports and be competitive in it and actually form, I guess, the main thing about it is forming an environment where becoming good at video games is seen as a positive thing and
mm.
having the encouragement and the environment to nurture that kind of thing as opposed to having people being like, why are you wasting your time playing video games? You know?
Right, yeah. And of course, that's not something that just happens in Japan. That happens
mm.
everywhere, I would think. It certainly happens in North America. It's happening less
mm-hmm.
in North America. And I couldn't sit here and tell you all the reasons why it is that the appetite for viewing esports and video games is bigger here. I'm not really sure why that is.
Yeah.
I would love to have theories on that. But for whatever reason, that is the case. So but that's not to say that it has for long been like that. That's
right.
A recent phenomenon over the last, I don't know, decade at most. At most.
And the crazy thing about it, too, is that, you know, Korea is like so accepted.
It has been there for a long
time. In China, you know, they watch League of Legends rabidly. You know, that they're obsessed with League of Legends in China.
Not just that. I mean, they play Dota.
King of Fighters. Shaohai is like, he's a celebrity over there. I heard Shaohai is just basically like a true celebrity over there.
I heard the same.
Yeah.
Couldn't tell you the veracity of those claims.
Dude, there was like that.
Heard the same.
There was that commercial we saw where they got actors to play Dako and Shaohai.
That's
like,
true.
They had like a dad like... pretend, you know, like an actor playing Shaohai's dad, and then like at the very end of the commercial it like does a crossfade into actually Shaohai and Dako.
Yeah.
Like, I don't even know what that commercial was for.
Me
but
neither.
It was like
we couldn't understand a lick of it, but
yeah,
I couldn't anyway.
So
apparently I was reading a whole spiel about Korea, and apparently there's a long time established tradition of people making games more of a career, even before video games.
Interesting.
So it's not
okay.
just that it's like a brand new phenomenon.
Right,
but
right.
Obviously,
right.
there were a lot of other things that fed into the, you know, PC bang phenomenon and all that stuff. So they were earlier. It's happening now in North America. It's happening in Europe.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, presumably it'll happen in Japan. I don't know, though. And so I like, one of the reasons I wanted to talk about this is that I liked Choco's
oh, cool. Someone
mindset.
Actually linked the Shaohai commercial.
There you go. Yeah, I really like Choco's mindset, sort of understanding what the issues are and working affirmatively to change that. I mean, like you mentioned, they have the school that they're doing.
Right.
They stream. Obviously, they play fantastically. Momochi is a champion. And I like, too, I gotta tell you, I like that Echo Fox has them. I like that EG had them before.
Mm-hmm,
I thought that was
mm-hmm.
very, very smart because they are helping to, you know, sort of create that in Japan. And if you are an esports team and you can find people who will help build a new market for you, that's what it's about, is building the new market. And even if they're not like the greatest players, obviously Momochi's great, Tokido, etc.
Mm-hmm.
But even if they're not, if they're making the market happen, then supporting that is good financial
it's
decisions.
It's crazy to me that Japan is like not all obsessed with it already, because I mean they make video games and everything, but
yeah.
It might just be like the gambling culture there. Because the thing about it is, I've actually heard, and I think Daigo talked about this in his book, like even like the Mahjong stuff, like a lot of those tournaments and competitions are very much tied to, like, not to be like weirdly stereotypical, but it's very tied to gang stuff like Yakuza and everything like that, right? So a lot of those kind of areas that have that kind of money get kind of tied into that kind of,
like, not viewed legitimately.
Yeah, because Daigo was talking about how, like, he was hoping to try to make video games not be seen as, like, some, like, CD Underground thing, like some other things, you know, like some other similar kind of competitions. I don't know. Like, it's weird to me that Japan isn't already esports crazy, you know? But
I don't know.
The fact that it is kind of this way right now, and I don't know, like, does Choco Blanca talk about anything that she feels like can change that idea, that culture?
She really wants to have this role model of somebody who makes a professional gaming a career, like some in like realistic story. Again, not somebody who's backed by $1 billion or spent 30 years doing it or whatever, but like somebody who it's like attainable and you can live doing it.
Right.
And so she wants to use that role model as like the genesis of hoping to get people to see that it's something you can do. I mean, I think that that's happened here in North America too. You know, I certainly know many people who, when they won money playing fighting games, you know, they would go back to their friends or family or whatever and say, "Hey, I won money." People would think, "Okay, maybe that's not a stupid waste of your time anymore."
Right? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
And
even when it was almost nothing, like when I would win a tournament in Street Fighter 4 and I go home, I'd be like, $50. I'd be like, wow, okay, that's pretty cool. Like, you know, so
just that's pretty good. Cause I mean, when I was like, hey, I won first place in this tournament, they're like, how much did you make? And I was like $100. They're like, psh. That was basically my parents' response.
Oh, well, okay.
Yeah.
So, you know, you can't win them all.
I was never appreciated for the talents that I had.
$50, dude. I was a millionaire.
I know, right? I remember Justin talking about, like, winning ECC, and, like, he got, like, $300, and he was like, I felt like the richest person
dude,
in the planet.
$300?
Yeah, I know. You could buy, like, a whole game console back then.
That was probably 500 top ramens.
Right.
At the time.
Maybe even still.
Yeah, I don't know. So, it's that's been obviously an important trend here too, that as people hear about or find out about folks who win money doing it, views of it change, and that's obviously a big part of why events like Capcom Cup wanted to say Knuckle D won, you know, $250,000 or whatever. That's valuable because it helps create the perception that this is a career.
Yeah, like two stories that kind of go with that. Like, so, you know, one of those things as an Asian person, like, you're really good at drawing when you're growing up. And then your parents are like, don't major in art. That's not going to help anything, right? I had a friend, a Chinese dude, who just defied his parents, majored in art, got great jobs, started making a lot of money. And then all of a sudden, all of their Chinese friends are like, why didn't you major in art? Like, so I'm like, money, you know, it's like money talks and that kind of thing. And then another example is like, I'll be talking to to people that I know, like doctors or whatever, and they're like, oh, what do you do? And all these kind of things like that. And when you're like, oh, these game tournaments or whatever, like, they're like, oh, really? I'm like, yeah, there's these big tournaments with all these people. Like, how much can you win? I'm like, well, this year at EVO, Street Fighter V was like $100,000+. And all of a sudden, they're like, whoa.
Yeah.
You
yeah.
know?
I've had the same experience.
It means a lot. Like, the money makes a difference. So, yeah.
For sure.
It really
for
does.
Sure. But, you know, not just the money. It's the money being used to prove that it can be a career. Because you're not just trying to win the hearts and minds of, you know, Joe 80-year-old. You're trying to win.
Right.
You're trying to get people to do it, right? To, like, play video games competitively as a career. So having that role model is important. I think she's totally right.
Yeah, some people are saying, well, Kevin7x says is like a lot of it is because that China and America and stuff like that, it's a lot of the esports stuff is PC-based. Like Korea.
Oh, for sure.
Because, I mean, the reason why StarCraft got so popular in Korea, I don't think a lot of people also know this little bit of history, but for the longest of time, Japanese video games were banned in Korea. You couldn't play them. That you could not play Japanese video games. You couldn't import Japanese things into Korea, right? So that is why there is a special DDR with Korean music in there, because it was made specifically for them. That's why there's a Guilty Gear XX version out there with a different soundtrack.
Is that the reason?
Yeah, because it wasn't official. Like, and so, but they had access to all the PC games. So they just played StarCraft instead of all the Sonys and the Segas and stuff like
Interesting.
That. That's obviously not the case anymore. Well, like that's changed a while ago.
Yeah.
But like that's why they're obsessed with PC games in Korea.
Yeah. I mean, I think that there's more to why they're obsessed with PC games having to do with internet cafes and people being out of work. There's a
right,
little story.
Exactly.
But that's an interesting piece of the puzzle for sure.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't know. Whatever the additional reasons are. Like, it's fun to sort of speculate as to what the reasons for this kind of thing are. It's hard to, like, nail things down. Why is the FGC different than other esports games?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. There's a whole bunch of reasons.
Right.
But it's, like, hard to nail it down. but it's fun to talk about why they are different. Importantly, though, I mean, I just wanted to say that I think Choco's totally right, that she needs to create that role model.
Mm-hmm.
For somebody to follow to say, okay, you know, I like video games. These are pretty sick. I'm pretty good at them. So if this can be a career, because X or Y dude's doing them.
Yeah.
Right?
I mean,
I can do this.
Those
too.
Two people are doing it right now. Choco and Momochi are literally doing it
there
right now. And they're expanding it. That's why they had that one event, remember? And they talked about all the things. That's why they're setting up that Korea versus Japan tournament. That's why they're like... I remember they talked about a whole bunch of different projects that they're working on. So, and now Choco's writing these articles like that, and I think
Thumbs
that's
up.
Really cool.
Thumbs up.
And I think Daigo is also a great role model for them to talk
sure.
about and everything. So, you know, and Tokido now as well, you know, on Echo Fox. So they've definitely got a lot of places to go. And
mm-hmm.
now you have this kid, Haku, who's just like tearing it up with Bison, you know.
John Takeuchi.
Oh, John Takeuchi. Dude, if Seijam's here, if he was here
All
right
he'd
now,
be talking
he'd
about.
Be like, man, just slap that Red Bull logo
yeah.
on him and have him sell money, you
yeah.
know?
Have that be all he's wearing?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's what he would say.
Dude, and
that is what he has said, in
dude,
fact,
at Cannes
in
Winter Clash, did you see those I don't think the little clips of John Takeuchi, like, every time the camera was on him in between matches,
yeah.
he'd be drinking the Red Bull, like, one time he drank it and, like, looked at the camera and, like, smiled. Then he, like, grabbed it again and it was empty, so he was, like, put it down, grabbed another can and opened it up.
He
dude.
Is a get. I will say
yeah,
that. I definitely agree with Seijin that he is a get
dude,
in terms
he is
of esports
like the
teams.
Most adorable... Like, he just put him on posters, and he'll be on, like, the Japanese, like, all these girls' walls, dude, in Japan. Seriously.
He'll be on Seijam's wall.
For sure. Ceiling. Probably the
ceiling.
Ceiling. The ceiling, yeah. For sure. For
mm-hmm.
sure.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Sell those pillows.
Mm-hmm. The pillow would probably be about as tall as John
Takeuchi.
Yeah, Takeuchi.
He's not a big
But that's what makes him, like, that's part of that marketability. He's just adorable.
Yeah.
Like, he looks like you could pick him up and bring him home with you. You know what I mean? Like, seriously, he does. Oh, man.
Anyway. and you know, Echo Fox, I think, like I said, I think they're doing a good thing. And EG was before.
Right.
And in supporting people who have this goal of helping to create
mm-hmm.
a bigger scene for video games and pro video gamers in their area.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
That's kidnapping.
He's 16? Is he 16 still?
No, I think he's
think
a little
so.
Older than that.
Yeah,
now.
I think he's a little older
yeah,
than that.
Yeah, I think he's a little older than that, so...
I thought he was 18.
Not... I'm just saying it looks like you could take him home with you. I'm not saying that you're supposed to.
Well, you
actually
could.
Do
I mean,
go
in terms
it.
Of what the word could means...
Right. I mean,
you could.
I mean, but what happens is...
You could take anybody home. It's...
But they end up... What they end up doing is slapping handcuffs on you, and I spent a day... I mean, you could spend a few days in jail. Jeez. Let's next topic?
Tricky topic. Gotta dance.
What were we talking about again? Shoot.
What? I'm not a dirty... Oh, right. I'm not very close to the age 18 anymore. That's so funny. That I was even telling you earlier today.
Uh-huh.
I am officially in my mid 30s which is cool to me.
Because mm-hmm,
right?
mm-hmm.
you know your mid 30s are like 33.33 plus a minutia to 36.67, right? And like
yes.
I'm technically in there now. So yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Uh huh.
Yeah, I would definitely be the like creepy old guy at the frat party now. Those happen every now and then. There'd be like some old frat dude who was in the frat 10 years ago, and he came and comes back to, like, relive his glory day for a night. And was always like, what are you doing, man?
I remember, like...
Yeah, work in
the morning. We went to, like, one of those, like, dance things, you know, like, where you try to learn to dance or whatever, like, with some of our friends. And this is when we were, like, in our mid-20s or whatever like that, but we would start dancing, and, like, you know, there's a lot of old people dancing there. And then there's those old guys who, like, always go to, like, your friends who are, like, the girls that are, like...
Oh, there's always the creepy old dude at a bar, sure. Yeah, I definitely play goalkeeper for, you know, female friends.
Oh, really?
Of mine,
really?
For sure.
Oh, okay.
For
okay.
sure.
Nice. But, yeah.
Block him off the pass. That physically happened, for sure.
Wow, okay.
I mean, not that there's anything to, like, really worry about. Just, you know, you box him out. Look, I have a hair appointment at 10 in the morning. Don't worry about it, okay? I just want to say that part of the reason that I realized that I was officially in my mid-30s is that I read that if you make it to your mid-30s and you haven't lost hair yet, you're probably good. You're probably going to be good.
Really?
And I thought to myself, all right.
I passed that a long time ago then. Okay.
There was actually a period of time when I was worried about that. I briefly did lose a little bit of, like, hairline receded, like, just a little bit. And I thought it was going to be a problem. But it turns out not to be, especially in the back. Look at this guy. That's got to take a couple pounds off of that guy. Anyway.
That's why I wear this headset. People always ask why I wear this during the stream. It's just so that I do not reveal my hair and how beautiful it is to everybody. Because then everybody would just, like, swoon and not pay attention to the words. They'd just stare at my hair all day. It's a true story. Absolutely true story.
Do the mullet. I did do the mullet once, as you know, internet.
I think this is the second week in a row we've talked about hair.
I had an appointment last week, and I had to push it back twice due to unforeseen reasons, work and personal. So, unfortunately, it didn't work out.
I mean, look, the only reason why I would agree with you, Misery, is because I am also twice the age of Sage Ham, and my hair is still pretty good, so...
Yeah, you're good at this point.
Yeah.
Like, it's pretty unlikely that you're gonna...
I mean, look, my brother, when he was in his mid-30s, you're right, he started losing the hair.
Yeah, that's why I've read.
So, there you go. There
and my
you
grandpa go. Had a full head of brown hair and
stuff. I like some people in the chat, like, can you please talk about Colleen
now? Oh, yeah, that's right, video games. Just do it right now. Just screw the cuts. I'll just...
Is there anything else you want to say about Choco Blanca's article?
It was only part one, and there's going to be...
Oh, really? Oh, okay,
so
cool.
Look for that.
Okay.
Good work. Let's move on.
Okay.
So, talk about Colin, who people are pronouncing as Colleen.
Yeah, because that's how it's pronounced in in-game. As
yeah,
well,
that's so. Right. But everybody says Karen anyway.
Yeah, I know. I Karen is the weird one, because I've been calling her Karen my whole life.
Yeah.
Like, I try calling
Micah.
Her... I tried calling her Karin, but I keep missing it. But it's not Micah, it's Mika.
It's definitely Mika, right. But some people say Micah.
Have some people actually said Micah?
Yeah.
Like the gold, like gold Micah? Like,
yeah.
Really?
Or like the Jewish male. Yeah, people have said that.
I don't think I've ever heard people say Micah before.
I've heard it only a couple
so
times,
but
I have heard it. Or like Elverling insists on saying Dormammu. It's not Dormammu, friend, but I hope that you never stop saying that, because it's very endearing to me. But yeah, he's been saying Dormammu for the whole time.
It just always makes me laugh, because, like, you know, people are typing colon in the chat, and it always makes me think of those series of tweets. Have you seen those series of tweets where, like girls will tweet out, like, I always love it when I smell his colon?
Yeah, I have seen that.
They don't
That's
know how
classic.
To smell cologne.
Yeah.
So everyone's like, I love having the smell of his colon on me.
Yeah. Genius. Anyway, Dormammu. So let's talk about Colleen.
Yes.
I haven't had a chance to play her. In fact, I've barely seen any footage at all after the you know, initial like streams that they had for her.
Right.
But you had a chance to mess with her a little
bit.
Well,
here's the question. If we take a quick break, I may be able to jerry-rig this that we could mess with her right now on stream.
Let's do it, man.
Okay, cool.
Do you want to maybe, like, run through the rest of the show, and then, like, we'll just do Colleen for,
oh,
like,
do you want to just do that?
What are we, like, are there any important events to talk about?
Oh, I mean...
Punk won King of New York.
Yep. Punk won King of New York.
He blew everybody up.
Yep.
He beat everybody.
Cam Winter Clash was this weekend, right?
John Takeuchi won. Congrats to him.
Yes.
Other people placed in the top 8.
Lots of stuff coming up this weekend. SemCal standoff is coming this weekend.
Yes.
Right?
Also, recently announced, famous esports commentator Ultra David is going to be commentating at the KI Cup.
Oh, really? Was that announced officially?
It was.
Nice. Okay. Which is going to be taking place on the same weekend as Final Round.
That's right. Also announced, famous esports commentator Ultra David is going to be commentating at Final Round.
Ooh.
True stories, friend.
Ooh. Some shenanigans going on. Shenanigans. So, in other words, David, you're going to be at one and Sage Jams at the other.
The Ultra David. Yes, he will be.
Okay.
But, so will I.
Okay. But, also, this weekend is going to be the grand finals event of the Tenkaichi Budokai, which is the Guilty Gear stuff that's been going on. So follow at 2DJazz on Twitter to get all the information on that. They just put out a playlist of all the matches up to this point, and I'm just going to sit down and basically binge on that for just a little bit. But you definitely want to watch that. That's going to be really, really super exciting.
Esports commentator Keats will also be part of it, he announced.
Of course, of course. No surprise. I know I was there last year. I am not going to be there this year.
Okay.
I'm not going to be at KI World Cup. I will only be at Final Round this weekend.
I am stoked for it, personally. I'm really excited to be there.
Let's see if there's anything else
in person
listed here.
And also in person at Final Round. You looking up what's coming up?
Yeah. Trying to see if there's any more. Let's see. There's going to be a Canada East Championships in Ontario this weekend as well.
Ontario, Canada.
Ontario, Canada.
In Toronto.
In Toronto. And there's going to be Street Fighter V, Super Turbo, KOF 14, Revelator, Marvel 3, BBCF, MKXL. It'll be streamed on Toronto Top Tiers and Toronto Top Tiers 2. Also, about that Tenkaichi Budokai, I forgot to mention that Tenkaichi Budokai will be streamed on twitch.tv/Jonio-san.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be dual audio. All even in the YouTube videos, it's dual audio. So if you have the ability to move the balance to this side or move the balance to this side, left is Japanese, right is English commentary done by 2DJazz himself.
Mm-hmm.
So that should
be
super exciting.
I like
to
do that.
More players were announced for the Red Bull Kumite. XYZZY was announced for the Red Bull Kumite. And,
Go on. Continue.
What are the other two? The other two were, there were both Europe players that were announced over there.
Oh, yeah,
so.
Rebel Kumite. Infectious and, Mr. Crimson?
I thought they were already announced.
Oh, were they already?
They,
okay.
Let's see here. So with 8 competitors already announced so far, Tokido, Bonchan, Mr. Crimson, Shaohai, Infectious, RB, PROG, and Nemo were already announced. But the new 3 players that are added are Phenom when we talked to him. So of course Phenom, XYZZY, and Luffy has been announced.
Red Bull Luffy.
Yeah, Red Bull's Luffy.
Obviously, that was
going to
happen. But yeah, XYZZY is very, very cool.
Yeah, I think that's super awesome.
Very interesting and strong choice for sure. So, Ken Winter Clash, Street Fighter V, won by John Takeuchi. 7th places were Pax Karen and Leo Laura. 5th places were GS TKR Chun and MD Mr. Crimson Dalsum. 4th was Takamura Ken. His Ken's been looking pretty sick over there.
Nice.
3rd was AWS Link Exilo with Nikali. 2nd place, RB Luffy. Mika, winner again, Jonathan Takeuchi.
See, Takeuchi did some crazy
FAB
stuff.
FAB1,
yeah.
Guilty Gear.
And then also this weekend was Red Bull. I'm sorry, Topanga.
Yeah.
Topanga in results. Results. Let's see if I can get the most recent results 3 days ago. Yep. So, just happened this weekend. Let's see here. Which stage are we in? So day eight, it looks like Mago beat Kazunoko 7-2,
mm-hmm.
which is really interesting because, you know, I feel like Cammy and Karen are very similar characters, and I feel like that they fight each other, you know, pretty competitively because you know, they both have this ground game, but Cammy has a better air game, and Karen has no anti-air game, but Karen has a slightly better ground game. But when talking to Punk, he was like, I think Karen beats up Cammy, right? He thinks that Karen wins that matchup. And here we see Imago winning 7-2 over Kazunoko.
Yeah.
So that's for sure. Pretty dominating fashion there.
For sure.
And then I did see a lot of this one. I saw Itabashi Zangief going up against Tokido. And like at first, I remember you kept saying, like, you know, you thought Zangief beat Akuma. And I was like, I can kind of picture that. And then I watched the match and I was just like, what the hell can Akuma do in this match?
What buttons does he press?
Yeah, like,
I don't
Tokido
know.
Was doing ridiculous, amazing things. He was playing super solid, and then he got EX SPD'd, and then like everything exploded. Like,
even worse than that is that I just don't know what you do in neutral as Akuma other than wait. He has good walk speed,
mm-hmm,
so
mm-hmm.
You can walk back and forth, but what's the threat? And
yeah, uh-huh.
I mean, Itazan really called that bluff. You know, he just wasn't worried that often about the neutral game. And some of Akuma's important tools, Gif can blow up, you know, in terms of how he enters,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
In terms of you can definitely V-skill react against Forward Fierce,
mm-hmm,
as pressure.
Mm-hmm,
like, you can definitely
cause
problems for that character.
When he had a lead, all he did was just, like, start crouch-jabbing a lot,
yeah,
and it was, like, really scary for Akuma to do anything.
I don't know what Akuma does. I mean, I played that matchup from both sides, and
yeah.
I still feel it's tough. Karen beat...
Well, so the score was Itabashi 7 to Tokido 3.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was a big one.
Banchan Nash fought against Mago's Karen as well. And Mago, so he won 2. He went 7-4 against Banchan. I did watch a little bit of that one,
mm-hmm,
as well. And then Gachikun Rashid went up against Kazunoko. I guess there's a rule that you have to win by 2.
Yeah.
And it ended up being Gachikun Rashid over Kazunoko Kami 9-7.
So that was the final day of the weekend.
Mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm.
Earlier, Gachikun basically was removed from
yeah.
contention, more or less, based on how he went against some other characters. So this was kind of like a moral victory.
Yeah, yeah.
But he had to make a huge comeback. Kazunoko was up.
Oh, you're
four,
right. 4-1.
It was
yeah.
a big, big.
Oh, you're
big
right. Episode. I read the last day. Let me go. So that was day 8. Let
yeah.
me go back to day 6 earlier.
Yeah.
So Nemo beat Sako 8-6. Yurian versus Akuma. Gachikun did lose to Mago's Karen 7-2. Galtu with M Bison beat Ata 7-2.
Mm.
And I remember seeing another Ata match where it just looked like, yeah, it was against Sako. That's what it was. So, but Kazunoko did beat Banchan 7-4. And then I did see Sako versus Ata. 7-3 Ata, and Ata was just, Sako could not figure out Ata. He was just EX uppercutting all over the place,
yeah.
and Sako just got hit by all these things, and then when he finally was like, oh, I'm gonna bait this out, nothing from Ata,
yeah.
and it was
he
like,
has great mix-ups for sure.
Yeah, and then Banchan beat Gachikun 7-2.
Yeah.
And then on day 7, Nemo beat Galtu, Yurian versus M. Bison 7-1. Now this one was interesting, because you always felt Bison did well against Yurian.
I did. I used to. Having seen that now, it's the movement that Nemo has.
Right.
But that's unique to Nemo. You watch other Yurians play and they're grounded, they walk back and forth, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But Nemo is a wild man. He's back and forth, he's doing everything. And if when Bison plays against characters like that are all over the place, that's tougher for him, for
right.
sure. Because mm-hmm. then he's just reduced to doing things like EX Devil's Verse that's like annoying, but it's like, you get 2 hits and
right.
you spent the bar for it, and it's like, okay. So, I don't know. It didn't seem as good as I thought.
Wow. Day 2 of this past weekend was full of dominations, huh? Tokido
mm-hmm.
Akuma versus Goichi Chun-Li, 7-0.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's hard to take.
He started with Guile.
Oh, he did start with Guile.
That
okay.
got mopped.
Oh, yeah?
It was,
oh, no.
I think, to quote Cien, not impressive.
Mm.
who was commentating. Or, I'm not impressed with this guy, whatever how he rephrased it. And then you switched to Chun, and it was basically the same story.
Chuns are not doing well.
They're not.
And this is something that Ludd talked about
Indeed.
A lot. He was just like, man, Chun-Li is just not good.
Yeah,
season.
It was interesting to hear when we were hanging out earlier.
Nemo did beat 7-5, so that was pretty close.
Including, did you see the sick anti-air mirror?
God, from full screen, you mean?
The mirror that effectively... I already thought Urien was good, but when I saw that he can anti-air not just here, and not just there, and not just with the roundhouse at the top of his head, but way out there with the mirror, I was like,
full
oh
screen jump, the safe jump over the fireball that no one can ever beat you up really for doing, and then all of a sudden he lost like 40% of his life off of
he actually
mirror.
Died.
Yeah, uh-huh.
But then I saw that in a different situation in training mode, and it does a grip of damage, like the full thing. Because that wasn't the whole thing. It was,
oh, yeah,
it was
that's
longer
right.
He gets three EX balls, or three balls. Right?
Yeah.
So that was cool. Then Sako blew up Galtu Bison.
7-2.
7-2.
And then Itabashi versus Goichi was super close, 8-6.
Yeah, that matchup is definitely better.
For Zangief.
Yeah, for Zangief. Mm-hmm. For sure. Now, the last day, praise be, Mochy couldn't make it. YHC Mochy could not go for whatever reason. I don't know what the issue was, but unfortunate that he couldn't go because I like to see him. I'm a big Dawson fan.
Of course.
Fortunate.
But?
Because he would have played against Itazan Zangief, and that would have been probably a blow up in favor of Mochy. So Itazan ends up doing really well. If you look at the final standings here of making it into the final stage.
Yes, he was. Okay.
That's it. You see, at the bottom of that section there, YHC Mochy does not have a fourth.
Oh, yeah, you're
name,
right. Yeah. Because
he couldn't go. So Itazan ends up 2-0.
Okay.
To take his group.
Yeah, so Tokido was 1-1, and then Goichi was 0-2.
Oh, Mochy had the like actual influenza? If so, that's no good.
Sucks,
I'm sorry to hear that, because that is a legit thing.
Yeah, and then in Group Y, Mago ended up winning that 3-0. Everyone else, Bonchan, Kazunoko, and Gachikun, all tied 1-2.
Yo, he had plus 13 game differential. Nobody else even had 0.
No,
everybody else was
negative.
He blew him up that badly.
Yeah.
Yikes.
And then in Group Z, Nemo took that with a 3-0 as well. And same situation. He was plus 10. And then Sako, Eita, Galtu, all 1-2, were all negative as well.
So go up to the final spots there.
Mm-hmm. It's going to be MJS Haitani, Echo Fox Momochi, GRPT Fudo, AW Alienware Nemo, DNG Itabashi, and Mago.
It's a good list.
That is a good list. That's going to be exciting to see. That's going to be exciting to watch. I'm hyped for that.
For sure.
I'm hyped for that. So.
All right, cool. Well, look for that moving forward.
Mm-hmm.
So, you want to do a break and then we'll do Colleen?
Let me think.
Anything else to talk about? Congrats to Filipino Cham for being a member of Splice, GG.
Oh, did it get announced?
It did.
Oh, okay. I mean, I just assumed he was going somewhere else because he left Panda Global,
yeah, for sure.
Right? And so I was just like, oh, something must be going on. And so I'm not surprised that, hey, look,
yeah,
he's on a new team now.
Yeah, congrats
so
to him.
Okay. Also, we talked about this during the break, but congrats to Infiltration. Apparently, he's either getting married or got married or something.
It's like some tabloid stuff. Yeah, congrats to him. I don't want to bring that up too much. What about, very interesting news, the three people moving on from each pool at Combo Breaker?
Yes. So apparently, that's something that they've been doing a lot at Smash tournaments.
Okay.
This is a format that Smash has run and has done for a while. So apparently, because I credited them, I was like, this is genius. And then Curly W and Rick both were like, well, we took this from Smash. But it is a great idea. So here's the rule, basically. It's the winner of the winners goes out just like before. But the loser of the winner's finals match and the winner of the loser's bracket before the loser's finals match. Both of those.
You gotta rewind for me, James. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Nice.
So normally you have the winner's finals where two people play.
Correct.
Whoever wins that qualifies. The loser of that goes and plays the losers of the loser's bracket side. And they fight, and whoever wins that.
The winner of
that.
The loser's bracket side. But yeah.
Right.
So
yeah,
one person qualifies having one in winners, one person qualifies having one in loser's bracket.
What the change now is that the two people who are in the loser's bracket who are supposed to play that last match in the loser's bracket both qualify into the semis and they get rearranged and paired up with different people.
Okay.
For the reason that when you play in pools, if there's three great people in pools, almost every single time that loser's finals match is a run back.
Right.
Because two of those people probably fought each other, you know, and then there's a good chance that they end up fighting each other again. There's four good people. The loser's finals match has a high percentage chance of being a run back.
Sure.
And so a lot of people end up getting double jeopardy.
Right.
So instead, what they're doing is they're moving that part out of the pools, moving it to somewhere in the semis, and starting from there, and they can re-pair up all those loser's bracket players so that they end up not getting double jeopardy.
That sounds great to me. So essentially, winner still qualifies from winner's side. Mm-hmm. Then loser's finals is not played in the pool. Instead, both of those players are just moved elsewhere
Yep.
in the second round.
Yep. It's a good idea. It's a great idea. Very, very great idea. But
I like it a lot.
Like I said, I talked to, I congratulated the Hado and Curly W for coming up with a genius idea. They said it was based off of Smash.
Cool.
Basically. So there you go.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to Logan. Okay.
Yeah, right. It looks like it's going to be pretty good.
It does.
Okay. Yeah. Let me see if there's anything else that I wanted to talk about. So there. Right when Filipino Champ left Panda Global, Last Stock Legends did a video for Panda Global, kind of like as a thank you F Champ video. I heard it's really good. I haven't had a chance to see it yet, but Last Stock Legends guys always make great content. So definitely check that out.
Definitely.
Let's see if there's anything else here. Oh, that's right. Dead or Alive is getting some costumes where characters can dress up like Blaze Blue and Guilty Gear characters.
What?
Yeah, so there's a Dizzy and Elfelt, a Noel. Yeah, it's interesting. And a Tarumi, I think it is. Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah. So
interesting. So they have Virtua Fighter character and Gear and Blaze Blue.
Actually, yeah. I want to talk to you about this from a legal standpoint. What do you think about that news thing that Twitch announced that they're going to be letting streamers sell games?
I hadn't heard about this.
So basically, streamers can be streaming games and be like, hey, if you like this game, here's a link to buy this game. And they get parts of the money for that.
Really?
Yeah.
It's just laying out there in the open.
Yeah, and what a lot of people are saying that kind of makes a problem is that it creates kind of this, like, now are streamers going to talk about games realistically?
Right. Of course, that's
right.
Immediately what the concern
is. Yeah, like, would you be, like, playing this game like, man, this game is shitty. Hey, this game is awesome. You guys should totally buy this. Here's the link. You know what I mean? So,
yeah, what's the incentive to say the game's bad?
Right. Exactly. So,
I don't know.
Do you think that this is a good idea, or do you think this
only
is
play good games? Well,
so someone in the chat says it's 70% game company, 25% Twitch, 5% streamer. So the streamer gets kind of screwed in this kind of whole thing too, but
I mean, it makes total sense from Twitch's perspective. They're always obviously looking for revenue streams, and this definitely seems like it could be one. And on the game publisher side, I guess I get it also, because they want to create sales more. And it's also helpful for them to know which streamers, which Twitch entertainers are like really driving sales.
Right.
And this is like an explicit way to be like, dude X is like bringing all the folks.
Dude, I'm telling you right now though, if that happens, I'm going to be peddling some Guilty Gear Revelator. I will tell you that right now. Because I know I've already gotten a bunch of people to buy that game, but you know, I'm just going to be like, dude, like, here's the link. Here's the link.
It is definitely true, Super D says, that streaming has always been a hustle, for sure, but this is, that's pretty explicit, you know? I don't know, it's...
Streaming as a hustle was always like, please, does my content entertain you?
Right.
Donate.
Right.
But now it's gonna be like, hey, this game is super fun, you should all buy it, you know what I mean? Like, now they could actually sell you something that's not fun. Like, you're not donating to the streamer unless you actually enjoyed him. And he can't fake it, because if he's faking being fun, then he's genuinely being fun.
Yeah, it doesn't matter if he's faking or not. That is not relevant, right?
Yeah.
He could be having a terrible time, and if other people are entertained, then he's doing his job.
Yeah, exactly, right? So there you go.
But it's what I would like to see that definitely won't and can't happen, I guess, is what if there was a fund that you could draw from where a streamer would play a game and be like, guys, this game is a pile of garbage. Do not buy it. And then you would click on his stream. Okay, I didn't buy it because of you. and then you like give him $5, the streamer. Thanks for saving me money, buddy.
Genius. It
definitely is not happening,
genius.
Obviously, but
genius.
That would be actually pretty sick.
Genius. I'm.
Thanks for saving me cash. You know, that actually.
Yeah. That's.
There's no incentive for that to happen,
yeah,
of course.
Yeah, I know, but that's genius.
Yeah, so I don't know. I guess initial reaction is that I don't love that idea. Because I would be worried about people getting bamboozled.
Right. Also announced recently, I'm super excited about this because everyone should buy Guilty Gear Revelator once I put the link up on my Twitch page. In all seriousness, no. Guilty Gear Xrd Revelator 2 was announced to come out for consoles in Japan on May 25th. I'm super stoked for that. I will probably buy the Japanese version if the release dates are far apart. But, like, I definitely want to do that. I definitely am super excited for that game. I know Johnny's getting nerfed. Whatever. I don't care. I'm just super excited about it.
So, briefly, I hadn't heard about this. I don't know if you had. Problem X and CCL were picked up by Mouse Sports.
I did hear. I saw.
That's awesome.
Somebody I forgot which one of them it was, but I saw one of them tweet about it. I saw
okay.
One of their tweets retweeted onto my.
Shout
timeline.
Out to them. That's a
yeah.
good sponsor. It's
uh-huh.
a good old
uh-huh.
esports team over there in the EU. On top of that, Majin Obama says.
Oh, Majin Obama's here.
To add to the esports bit in Japan, there was an event this past weekend that took place in Japan called JESPA.
Mm-hmm. For Guilty Gear Xrd
Revelator. Second year they organized an event like this. Production stage organization was all super clean. The titles they ran were Overwatch, CSGO, FIFA, Guilty Gear, and DOA.
Nice.
It was a pretty cool event, and it's a big deal because they awarded cash prizes, which is rare in
mm-hmm.
Japan. So yeah, things are changing.
Yeah, I know that footage
he
is
says.
Currently on M. Da Silva's page, who does a lot of Guilty Gear stuff, and I may be doing a DHC of that very soon. So look forward to that. I'm super excited for that.
Mouse.
What happened?
No, very, very cool. Thanks for the words.
Okay.
Is that cool? Is that it?
Let's see. Next
there's
going to
be an Injustice character reveal Thursday.
March 2nd.
They basically leaked Green Arrow.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Uh-huh, uh-huh.
So, that might be the dude. We'll see.
Also, I saw that they mentioned that the Marvel vs. Capcom Infinite, you know, they promised a expansive story mode in that game. Someone said that it's going to have nothing to do with the MCU, that it's just going to be its own standalone story.
That makes sense, I suppose.
Mm-hmm.
It'd be kind of sick, though, if they, like, officially tied in, like, Ryu to,
right.
like, the larger universe, you know?
They did announce that First Attack is returning on September 2nd through 3rd. I really hope we can make it back there again because I just want to go and eat more Puerto Rican food.
That was awesome. Naptown Clutch happened. I'm sorry I forgot to talk about that.
Yeah,
Marvel 3
yeah,
was
course,
won by Ray Ray. Seventh,
over Chris G, right?
Indeed, Chris G got second place. Seventh places were TTCP, I'm Ares Baby with Taskmaster Sentinel Doom. Remy Martin also, Magneto, Doom, Virgil. Hi, I'm Nasty went there. Captain America, Iron Man, Scroll was fifth place. NB Static Alpha also fifth, Viper, Doom, Strider. Fourth was Dual Kevin, MB Dual Kevin, Deadpool, Dante, Hawkeye. Third was Kane Blue River with Hulk, Sentinel, and Hagar. And yeah, Chris G second, Ray Ray first. Mm-hmm. Ray Ray is ridiculous. Oh my goodness.
Dude, he's get...
Some of the things he did were like Marvel 2 Magneto.
You
and
know,
he did it with Doom and Sentinel.
The craziest
like...
thing. The craziest thing right now is that Evo Marvel is just turning out to be the most interesting storyline because everyone's like, repeat champ, but right now it's like Ray Ray and Ryan LV.
That'd actually be super sick.
And Ray Ray is, he's like a lot of the other players who eventually won, got second place a bunch of times.
Mm.
I mean, well, at least once. He got second place once. So he was right there. He could taste it.
Yeah.
And so I know Justin, Chris G, Filipino champ, before he won, I think they were all like really high up there in previous tournaments.
And then KBR got second place afterwards.
Yeah,
right?
He got first and then second.
Dang.
So.
What a world. What
yeah.
a world. Street Fighter V, seventh place, MB Dual Kevin Rashid, also Diablo Bison with Bison. Fifth was Romance
mm-hmm.
with Kareem.
Which
fifth
is
place,
awesome.
Also Banana
Great
Jane Ibuki.
Job to him.
Fourth place, TS Arturo Sanchez, Dalsum. Third, Dark Child Balrog. Second place, Wolfcrone Laura, Winner, EG, NY Chris G.
That's pretty good. That's
Sky Island Urian, yeah. Romance won, KOF 14.
Yeah, I want to mention that about Romances. He would not have been there if it were not for Justin Wong. He was another Justin Wong. You know, remember how he flew Shine out to a bunch of events? This time he said, you know what, Romance, you're an awesome player. I'm flying you out to NapCon Clutch, NapTown Clutch, so you can win KOF. And that's exactly what he did. And he got fifth place at Street Fighter V.
He's good. He's a good player.
Yeah, shout outs to Romance.
I've played him online a couple of times. First time, totally dicked around because I was like, nuh-uh, to be honest. And I got busted.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay.
The second time we played it legit, it was a really good match. But yeah, the first time I was like, nah.
Because
he was really good.
I still remember playing him in CEO, not in tournament, but like casually in a hotel room. He was trying to learn Street Fighter. He was playing Sakura. And let me tell you, he was not good. And so to see, I mean, obviously he's a fantastic gamer in general. So it doesn't surprise me that he's super good now, but it just makes me excited and happy. Because before he was asking questions like, it was like, I can't, like, why does this work in Street Fighter as opposed to how it works in KOF?
Yeah.
Like he was asking those kind of questions. Why would you do this in the Street Fighter? This doesn't make any sense.
Sure.
But like, the fact that he was able to wrap his head around it and now he's a super strong player in Street Fighter V makes me super excited.
Totally, man.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to do this Colleen thing
now.
Okay.
Let's take a break.
When we come back, we're going to talk about Colleen in Street Fighter V.
Despite the fact that it was highlighted this whole time and we haven't been talking about her. Oops. Sorry. Okay, be right back, guys.